This is Geektastic Weekly for August 21st, 2005. The second video game crash is a certainty. And welcome to episode 4. We're already at our fourth episode.
Number 4
in the show, and we're already doing a format change. I've been looking at what we've been doing with the show, and it's not exactly going in the direction that I'd originally envisioned. I wanted this show to be unique. I wanted it to be different from every other tech show that's out there. Like, everybody's doing the same thing. So, what's going to happen is, the news section that we would normally have at the beginning of this show is going to become its own separate program. That will be once a week. We'll take the big news highlights from the week, and we will do what we do, what we usually did at the beginning of the show is we'll talk about them, give our own insights into them, what they mean, and it'll likely be a shorter program once a week. Then this show will be every 2 weeks, again, and the same format as the main topic, and then the other show I was doing, which I haven't released a new episode in a while, is Geektastic Quickies. That will no longer cover news. That will be tips, tricks, and suggestions that I find on the web that I think might be interesting for gamers, people who are into technology, basically stuff that can help people. So that's what that's going to be about. And getting in line with the direction that I'm wanting to take the show. Today's topic is the reason why I created this show in the first place. Why I wanted to do this show. And, you know, I've been wanting to talk about this. And there aren't many people who are. And some of the few people who are talking about this are Jim Sterling, who does Jimquisition. He does a few things for the gaming magazine, The Escapist, in Australia, and he's close friends with Yahtzee, who does the zero punctuation reviews. And there is Rich from Review Tech USA, who talks about this, but not a lot of other people. IGN is not talking about this, Machinima isn't talking about this, and it needs to be brought up. And I recently saw an article on cracked.com, of all places. And it was written by JF Sargent and David Williams. And David Williams is a game developer. So he's in the industry. He's inside the industry. And they wrote a review, they wrote an article to the 5 reasons why the video game industry is going to crash. And I agree with all their points. And we're going to talk about them today.
Yes.
Why we think another video game crash, second video game crash, is pretty much a certainty.
It definitely seems like it's pretty much we're heading that direction, basically.
Now, one of the big reasons why the industry is in trouble, and this is one they point out, is non-gaming people are in charge of the business.
Ah, attack of the lawyers.
Yeah, basically that.
Who are the committees?
You've got business school graduates, you've got lawyers who are in charge of the companies, the big AAA studios. They don't understand gaming. They treat it just like any other commodity. It shows the way they're treating it. I mean, look at what happened with Dead Space 3, where you had to buy download content just to craft items. Certain items in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And now, recently, with a multiplayer feature in Metal Gear Solid 5, is going to require you to pay with a certain kind of game currency that you can buy separately. In a microtransaction.
I think, when it comes to microtransactions, if done properly, I think it can create an okay situation where the company can make money and offer free to pay, but if they are doing it because their sole purpose is to make money, it's DOA.
Yeah.
I know for me, personally, I looked at Microsoft's Project Spark, for example, recently. I looked kind of interesting when I saw the promos for it. I think it was what showed at was it E3?
It was shown at E3, and mm-hmm. it looked promising.
I remember watching that, and I thought, maybe give it a shot. And so I got the game, I downloaded it, and started playing it, and I realized very quickly that, besides the fact that I couldn't get past the tutorial because it hung on me, that the bulk of it was about, looked to me anyway, like it was all about purchasing stuff in order to make stuff, and that sort of kills the creativity, because how do I know I'm going to like something until I get it? By the time I've gotten it, I've already paid for it.
Yeah.
And that kind of left a sour taste in my mouth, and I'm like, I'm kind of done with this. And I dropped it, put it back down. It messed with it since.
Well, there's a big difference between a free-to-play game with microtransactions, and of course, microtransactions done wrong in a free-to-play game, show.
Oh, yeah, they do.
But
they limit you from playing the game.
But there's a big difference when you have a game that you pay $60 for, and then they charge microtransactions on top of that in order to do stuff. In Metal Gear Solid 5, there is a feature in the multiplayer where you can create separate bases.
Mm-hmm.
And these bases give you additional resources and personnel and things, and they allow other players to come in and invade your bases, and you can invade other people's bases. You buy these with coins that you can buy through microtransactions.
I think the danger in this, and I haven't played that, but it sounds like to me that was a pay-to-win system.
Yes.
Because I think what people don't like is they don't like going up against people with a pay-to-win system, because then the big guy with the biggest wallet wins.
Yeah, because you can buy these coins. You can earn them in-game, but you can buy them.
I think one of the most recent pay-to-play... Or not even, no, it was a microtransaction system. One of the most recent ones I encountered. I like the system, the game actually, I stopped playing it for other reasons. But there was a game, what was it called? RoboCraft, I believe was the name of it.
Yes, RoboCraft.
Where you built robots, and basically you could purchase the parts. Now, you didn't have to purchase the parts. It did not require you to. You earned points for each match you played. And so you essentially could play the game for free, and what would happen is you'd play it for free, and you'd earn the points, and you'd get the parts. Mm-hmm. But if you wanted to speed the process up, you could pay a premium, and you would essentially award bonus points for each match that would total how much for your premium pay, and then you would proceed even quicker through the system. Where it wasn't a pay-to-win, it was a pay just to speed up the gaming process to kind of get through it quicker. Something it didn't prevent you from doing anything, it just enhanced it. It just sped it up so you can get through it quicker if you were in a hurry.
Yeah.
And that was fine, and I even opted in for it for a small time. What killed it for me in that game was the imbalance for their railguns.
Yeah.
Were a little overpowered, and I haven't gone back to see if they've adjusted any, but it was a little overkill.
I haven't gone back to play it. Either.
Yeah,
it was definitely overkill.
It was overkill. Basically, you'd have you'd have all the armor you could possibly build in one shot from these guns, and it was total annihilation.
Mm-hmm.
And after a while, that got old.
You know, someone would
build. There was no way to counter it.
Basically, someone would put a seat, a balloon, and a gun, float up to a corner of the map.
They're pick everybody off.
Pick everyone off from a distance.
Yeah. And what happens to my profile made it almost impossible
and
to hit.
It just killed the fun.
It killed the fun, big time.
Yeah. But with these people who have no experience in the gaming industry running the companies, I mean, they literally think that the only games that succeed are branded titles, sequels, and reboots. And that's why we've been getting nothing but brand titles, sequels, and reboots up the wazoo.
Yeah, there's been a lot of it.
Right. And they don't think that certain genres work. They look at these limited studies and say, oh, this particular subject doesn't work. Like, a sci-fi RTS game. Oh, that's not going to succeed. And then someone comes out with one.
Mm-hmm.
Or, a big thing was Space Sims. For a long time, they believed Space Sims were dead. Nobody wanted Space Sims. And then, all of a sudden, Star Citizen showed up on Kickstarter.
Everyone's waiting for it.
And it's become the most... It's become the largest crowdfunded game in history.
Yeah.
And it's really shaping up. I mean, a game of that complexity is taking a long time to develop. I mean, it is taking a long time.
It
does. Time.
I mean, it takes time to make games. Yeah. There's a lot of work involved. There's a lot of stuff to do. You know, now it helps the more people you have, but that costs money.
Yeah.
You know, because you have to pay these folks. You know, so it costs time. It costs money. It's yeah. And the nicer you want it to be, the more expensive it is. And what it looks like to me is when you get to these large companies, they go by these studies, and the additional component to that is. They go with, okay, well, this was successful, let's just stay with that.
Mm-hmm.
And any kind of experimentation ideas are thrown to the wayside.
And therein lies some of the problem. I mean, we're getting Call of Duty after Call of Duty after Call of Duty games. And the same thing with Battlefield. And what's going on is people are getting tired of it. And I think EA knows this. That's why they tried to change things up with their last Battlefield game, which was basically Cops and Robbers. Battlefield Hardlines.
Yeah.
Instead of Modern War. And it sold? I think it did somewhat fairly well. But a lot of what people are saying about the game, it wasn't that great.
Yeah. I think the thing is, one of the things, it's always best, and some companies will actually advertise this as a feature. It used to be a slogan from, I think it was Interplay or one of the others that said, "By gamers, for gamers." And where you
have that used to be EA back in the day.
Yeah, when the guys who make the games love playing them, rather than the people who are making the games don't like playing games.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, they don't care about it. It's just a job for them, and they're in it because it was part of their degree from college, and, you know, the kind of people who write an article, and it starts out with, what's the word? Abstract. It's the word you see at the top. And it's like, okay, what is this? And I get the point of what they're trying to do, but sometimes you can reach a point of complete lack of understanding about what you're talking about, even though you sound like an expert, you really don't know nothing about it. Yeah. And I think that's what you have, is a lot of people who are coming into the industry from colleges and universities and whatnot, who, you know, are being hired by these companies, and, you know, you mix that in with lawyers, and what you wind up with is something that is not fun.
I think what I went to college in the very early 90s, I had some college, and what you were learning and what you later experienced in the real world had this disconnect.
I mean, it's not to say that that everything is useless, but correct application of the knowledge in far as what you're trying to do. I mean, especially when you're dealing with games, if you don't enjoy playing games, if you're like one of those people who like just don't get it when it comes to video games, don't try to make them. If you're not a gamer, if you don't enjoy sitting down for you know, 6 hours at a whack and can sit down in front of a console and be able to play it, don't. Mm-hmm. Because all you're going to do is just make a miserable game for everybody.
Yeah. It's like the developers are gamers. The people who actually code the games.
Most of them would be designers. They're in it because when you get down to the nuts and bolts programmer guys, they're going to probably more likely to be gamers, more than often. Because, I mean, they're technical-minded, but they can sit there and do something for a long period of time. And usually, that's why they're there. They're doing it because they have a passion for it. It's not so much them. It's usually your design and executive staffs.
Yeah.
And the gaming industry is not the only industry that kind of has this kind of problem.
Oh.
Movies and music sort of have it, too, but it's kind of a more of an issue with the gaming community, I think, because there's an interactiveness that gamers sort of expect from the companies that they don't get from some of these companies. It's like you're just talking to a brick. There's nobody home. They're so big, there's nobody to talk to. There's no feedback. The companies that have done well, the companies that actually sit down and listen to their players, get feedback from the players, do use every tool, technique, and trick in the trade to be able to communicate with their fan base. Mm-hmm. Those are the ones that do best, because they're the ones who learn truly who their audience is and be able to interact with that audience and be able to produce something that they know that audience wants. Some games are doing it well. Some companies are doing it well. Some companies are doing okay, and some companies are completely deaf.
Yeah.
I think EA is probably in the deaf category.
That's what Cloud Imperium Games is doing with Star Citizen. It's like the community is deeply involved in it.
Right.
And then there's Epic with the next Unreal Tournament, mm-hmm. and that is being done in tandem with the community. The community's actually involved in the development of that game.
Right. And sometimes it can be hard for a larger company where they got a large staff and large people, a complex game. It's hard to kind of take in, and you sort of, it goes back to the old cliche, you can't please all the people all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't really, you'll never be able to do that because everybody's always going to have a take on what they want. But you try to figure out what are the things that make the most sense and, you know, kind of navigate around, you know, the trolls. Figure out what is, when somebody presents you with a good argument of why something might exist, and you look at how many people are saying, hey, we'd like this too, you know, you gotta kind of stop and take a good look at that and say, you know, what is it they're trying to tell us about this game, mm-hmm. whatever it happens to be. I mean, Final Fantasy does this. Square does this with Final Fantasy 14, is they look at what's on the forums, and they take a long look. Take the Bard example for recently. They threw out a lot of different new jobs and stuff like that, new abilities. And they got a lot of feedback when it came to one of the Bard abilities.
Wanderer's Minuet.
Wanderer's Minuet. And it was such a massive response that Square said, okay, we get it. We'll change it.
We talked about that in our first episode.
Yeah.
They changed it from 3 seconds to one.
Yeah, and this is an example of where they listened to the community and they balanced it out and it came out to be a better experience. And now the job is more enjoyable. Mm-hmm. And that's true for all the other games that are out there of, you know, listening to what the people want rather than just, you know, just feeding them whatever just happens to be on the plate next without any regard of what the fans even care for.
I mean, the execs they just don't understand it. I mean, having an always online feature for a single player game is never a good idea. And the developers who are gamers themselves would know instinctively that's not a good idea. But these execs think, oh, it's great.
That's because they've been listening to their lawyers and not their programmers.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, it's like everyone's like, oh, you gotta watch out for copy protection and stuff like that. You know, when it comes to piracy and stuff like that, honestly, if there are people going to do it, they're going to do it. But if you're charging reasonable rates, if you're charging reasonable stuff, you know, it's not, I'm trying to think if there was something that I was doing recently that I picked up. And I can't remember what it was. Where I knew how I could get this thing for free.
Yeah.
But I didn't because, you know, the company's selling it and I, you know, am, you know, where it's something that I like. Generally, gamers and players and stuff like that mm-hmm. enjoy the content. Generally, you know, it's you just know. If you want these people to make more games that you like, you buy their stuff.
Yeah.
And if the stuff is reasonably priced, hello, that, you know, there's no need. And there are systems in place, like Steam, that have a reasonable balance between, you know, just sitting around cracking a game just for the sake of cracking it, and basically releasing the title and having it the most flexible. You know, like, for example, you know, mods for Skyrim or mods for Skylines or any of these other games are heavily mm-hmm. moddable, but, you know, they're tied to the Steam system. You can't just drag them off and run them anywhere. Whereas you have what Microsoft's trying to do with their Windows 10 line of games, and it's like, yeah, mods, no, thanks for the offer, but we'll have to pass type of response.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's not going to fly. It's not going to fly long term.
That's why you don't see big titles. That's why you don't see big titles released as modern UI apps. That's why That's the reason why Valve started working on SteamOS.
Yeah.
And why Gabe Newell said Windows 8, he said Windows 8 at the time was a disaster.
Yeah. Well, we're past Windows 8, but I don't think you're going to see Windows 10 functionality helping it any at all.
No.
I mean, they've got a good base concept, but the fact that it's locked down the way it is basically, it makes it DOA.
Yeah.
But this is getting off topic. This is about copy protection. We're talking about the crash, so. But
yeah, it's still related.
It is related in that this is one of the things. Look, for example, if you want to talk about an effect, what it can do, why it's these little things are important, is because look at SimCity. EA destroy, basically got rid of Maxis. Everyone was kind of like RIP Maxis because. You know, they made one of the most beloved games of all time, SimCity, and I just knocked something over. And yet they killed the company, even though they had one of the most famous, most well-known, longest-loved franchises around. And it wasn't because the game was bad. Everybody who played SimCity who loved SimCity. It was what they did to SimCity, was it 5? SimCity 5? Yeah, it was what they did to SimCity 5.
Yeah.
It was, you can't play this because it has to be online.
Oh, the visuals were gorgeous in the game.
Yeah. I mean,
it looks like tilt-shift photography, and the lighting effects are really good. I mean, better than...
A lot of what went into City Skylines was modeled after that look.
Yeah.
But what they had would have been fine. Had they not tried to tie it up in knots.
The problem is they rolled back a lot of features that SimCity 4 had, and they were going to offer them as DLC.
And see, this is the thing, is this is a lack of understanding, and this is the point that kind of ties back into it, a lack of understanding by the execs, whoever, decide what is a feature or what isn't, to do something that is completely contrary to what anybody who plays games in the gaming industry knows you ought to be doing or ought not to be doing. It kind of, it's a symptom of that. It's one of the things that is leading to things starting to come apart.
Mm-hmm.
That and what they did with Spore, watering it down and stuff like that. I've never forgiven for that.
Will Wright's not even in gaming anymore because of that.
Yeah. And so here you are, you've lost... literally a genius, an Einstein for gaming, to the wind because of a company's lack of vision and ability to do it, and the execs being completely devoid of understanding. This is how much damage they've done. And this is a cumulative effect. Over time, it's creating this long-term schism, this crack, that's going to turn into a crevice. And this is going to keep spreading until something bad happens in that everyone's kind of slowly... And you're already seeing people trying to break away from it as fast as they can go.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think what's going to happen is we're heading for a point where these companies like EA and people are just going to be like, just going to just stop buying the crap. It's just going to stop. It's just everyone's going to be... There's going to be this strange point of disinterest.
Yeah.
And when that begins, they're in... deep trouble.
We're starting to see that. I think that's why we saw a shift with Battlefield to something different. Well, something that on the surface was different. I think EA may have been seeing this. They might. I would hope that they're smart enough to know that things are changing, the winds are shifting. They need to change.
Well, if they don't change, you're not going to survive in being a monolithic take our crap or leave it kind of mentality
mm-hmm.
in a world full of open sourced, public or open funded,
crowdfunded
projects, which are going to start rivaling their products, and people are going to be getting what they want. That's where you're going to start seeing EA and then fall off the map. Is when these crowdfunded games, as this becomes a new thing, and it's got its own set of, issues, but when these kinds of things start producing quality that you would expect from EA on fractions of the budget, you know, with fractions of the team, and yet the quality of the game, and yet everybody had input, and it came out to be the game that everybody wants. What we're looking for is when you start seeing those kinds of games come out, and there's no way EA can keep up with that. Once it begins, once you get people like Will Wright and all these other really great game authors, when they start getting into that environment, when that open community starts picking up these kinds of people and they start directing these kinds of projects and figuring out how to make this work, that's when everything's really going to just fly apart. Yeah. It's going to happen. You know, it's just eventually going to happen, and people are going to look at EA and go, you're a dinosaur.
Mm.
You know, we don't want to buy your crap. We can get better games from this process.
You know, and speaking of budgets, they are skyrocketing. They're just going out of control. What was it? GTA 5 had a budget of most big budget films.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was outrageously high. I mean, like 500 million.
You know, considering how many music tracks in there, I would not be surprised if a good portion of that was just fees for licensing. I would not be surprised if a big chunk of that budget. I would be curious to know what their licensing fee budget was.
Yeah.
Because I bet you a big chunk of that was nothing but license fees.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how much it cost, but I bet you that was a big chunk of it.
Likely.
And, you know, the funny thing is, I've seen a, what city is that? That's San what?
I've already forgotten.
It's not San Andreas, it's San, I haven't played it in a while. My brain's farting on me here.
Yes.
Brain
fart.
I have to cut this out because it's too embarrassing to forget the name of the city in that game. Yeah. Anyway, but I've already seen people. I've already seen that whole map.
Los Santos.
Los Santos. That's what it was. I knew it was Los something. It wasn't Las Vegas. I knew it was Los Santos. I have seen a map of that in amazing detail in City Skylines.
Ah.
Amazing detail. And I love the map warning. It said, you'll want to run this map with infinite budget because, well, the city's going broke. I said, well, that's kind of appropriate. <It's>
you know what's amazing detail? But I've been playing The Witcher 3. And the detail of that is pretty amazing.
Now, who made that?
CD Projekt Red.
And how much do you know how much they spent on it?
I do not know. I know that they're not a very big company. They started out as an indie studio. And they're being published through WB.
And see, this is the interesting thing is, and see, the thing is, nowadays with Steam, you don't even need a publisher, although it helps. Yeah. It helps to have the advertising and whatnot, and I think what you're going to wind up seeing is more games coming from, this is the thing you're seeing. And I think this is just a broad statement that I think can be basically quantifiable as true, is that you're seeing better and better and better games. More rich detail, better games from smaller staffs and smaller companies with smaller budgets that are starting to be able to produce things that, you know, is overkill for some of these large studios.
I've noticed that a lot of the really good ones are also coming from Europe. Because CD Projekt Red is from old Eastern Europe.
And Skylines was Colossal Order from, I think, were they from Belgium or not? No. I forget where they're. I think they're Swedish or something. Yeah. I forget what they are, but they you know, you had a small team of people, like 12 people. They're up to like 200 now. They said, but they had a small team of 12 that made that game, and that's the thing. It's like a small company, 12 people, and they made a game that just completely blew away a mega corporation, giant EA, to the point where EA is throwing away this brand into the trash can and sealing it away in a vault forever. And yet this little company with 12 people have completely blown it away and giving fans what they want. They're adding a daytime, nighttime cycle soon.
Mm-hmm.
They're, you know, you got tunnels now in the game. There are mods galore for it. You know,
they've taken the city simulator crown away from them.
They have. They didn't just, they, it was complete city. TKO on EA on that. And, you know, how long is it going to be before the other genres out there that starts happening with the other genres? If it can happen once, it can happen again.
Like The Sims and first-person shooters,
mm-hmm.
like that. there was the Metro games, which are based on Russian post-apocalyptic novels. And those were very good. The story was excellent.
Yeah.
And from what I understand, the jump for these massive budgets in these games literally happened overnight. And these companies had little time to adapt for that.
I don't know what they're spending it on that creates and that had so much need for such a large budget.
Apparently, between the PS2 and the PS3, the budget's just doubled.
Here's the question: Is this because of the manpower, or is this just because of licensing? I mean, where does this come from? What is eating them alive that they need such a large budget? I wonder.
Because they need to get these games out as fast as they can in order to stay afloat. A lot of AAA studios, they're one huge failure away from bankruptcy. And if they don't keep games coming in a regular schedule,
they've patterned themselves into a corner.
They patterned themselves into a corner
by producing games so rapidly. Because look at Bethesda. Bethesda was putting out a Skyrim game, every 5 years at one point? Mm-hmm. And they're not even talking about another Skyrim or another Elder Scrolls game for a while.
Yeah.
I'm not completely pleased with the way ZeniMax is handling ESO. But, I mean, they're not even talking about it. Now, what are they working on? They're working on...
Could have been worse.
Yeah. They were working on Fallout right now. Mm-hmm. They're focused on one thing at a time. Now, what could they do? They could sit there and hire, dozens and dozens and dozens of more people, and then multi-chain the process and have, two or three ESO games in queue, and two or three Fallout game in queue, and, a development team with 20 patches in queue, and all of it, so they could literally put out on a 3 month cycle, you're getting a new, whole new, full game and everything. And, how's that going to make the game even better? It ain't. You're going to wind up with a game buggy, crummy, rushed, adding more people, putting more hands in the pot, spreading out. It does not necessarily mean it's going to be better. It's good to have talented people, but when you're basically turning your entire shop into a, car factory, an automated car factory, then you wind up with the same product repeatedly over and over and over. And ironically, this is sort of what it feels like at EA. They've turned it into a car factory. They're having to pay a lot of money to run that car factory, and just like a car factory, they turn out the same model over and over and over with a new paint job.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. That sums it up. And just like anything like that, after a while, you're looking for a new model, and it's too hard for them to retool that shop too quickly.
Oh, yeah. The development has changed, but how they run the business hasn't, and it's slowly beginning to catch up on them.
Yeah, there's going to come a point where they're not going to. It's going to come a point where people are going to just stop buying it because, why do I want to buy the next one? I already got it. I don't think there are people who buy the games just because, but there's going to come a point where they buy the next game, and they look at it and it's like no different than the one they just bought, and they start thinking, wait. Maybe the next one would be better. And then by the next one, it's the same thing. And they're like, all right, I bought the one with... The thing that changed was the number after the name. Called 1, 2, 3, 4. And I'm not getting anything new here. It's the same thing. It just rearranged paint job. But eventually, it's going to catch on. But the next one comes out, and they're like, you know what? Screw it. I'm skipping this.
Now, I bought off Steam when EA games were still on Steam. I bought Bad Company 2. And that was a good game. The single player was pretty good. And the multiplayer was okay. And then I had bought some computer hardware. And I had gotten Battlefield 3 free. Through that. No, it was Battlefield 4 I got free. And I installed Origin for it. Because I had gotten it with the piece of hardware. And then when I went on Origin, I saw Battlefield 3 was being offered free. So I downloaded that. So I played Battlefield 3, and then I played Battlefield 4. why a new game, because this is literally almost the same stuff.
Yeah.
There's not much difference. I mean, other than, you know, a slight visual clarity change and slight UI change, but it's essentially the same game.
Yeah. And sometimes the same is okay, but sometimes it's detrimental after a period of time, and that's what's going on, is it's becoming detrimental in that it's no longer innovative, and people are just looking at it going, I've seen this already.
That's one of the main things that's being hurt by these massive budgets, is that there's no room for innovation, no room for taking risks. They're sticking with what they see works, and that's it.
By the time it catches up to them that what they think works doesn't work, by the time they've done that, they've gone bust.
Yeah. It's like, story in the games was bland. I mean, the story in Bad Company 2 was interesting because you had these guys that were part of this group. They were called Bad Company. And there was a camaraderie between them. Mm-hmm. The characters had personality. Battlefield 3 and Battlefield 4, you didn't care about these guys.
Yeah.
I mean, they were bland. There was no personality.
And this is something I told a friend of mine the other day, was you can have the most complex gaming system on Earth, the most mechanics and the most intricacies and all that, but if you ain't got a good story to back it up, unless you're making a Pac-Man game, you can forget it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can have games that have no point story as a point to the process. I mean, look at the old classics. I mean, they had no story whatsoever. Sometimes they did. But they weren't that kind of game. They weren't in the vein of the kind of games we have nowadays, where storytelling is a part of the process. And there's a thing to storytelling that you really got to be able to do right. And like any story, if the story sucks, no one's going to want to listen to it.
There was somebody I talked to who was a game developer, and they had come out and said that a lot of the big game companies, story takes a back seat to mechanics.
Yeah. And see, this is the thing, is story, this is why, like I said, I think Heaven's Word was so much more successful than Realm Reborn, is because its story is more intricate, it's more involved, it's deeper. You really feel like you're on a journey with these characters. They even tie you down a little bit and go, pay attention to the story right now. You can go look around later. They put you in the story. Other games where, you know, the story is the integral component to it, even if the game mechanics are slightly broken, people will kind of tolerate even a slightly broken mechanic if the story is compelling enough to make them want to work through it. As long as the broken mechanic doesn't cripple it, you know, even if it's a little off balance, people will still muddle through it just because they want to know what happens next. And the story is everything.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, storytelling does not just for books or movies. Storytelling is for games. And, I mean, that's what hooked me. Now, some people don't care for the story. They just want to run around and shoot things. And, you know, you got your trolls out there and all the other stuff. And you got other people out there who just like to run around and, you know, pretend they're a soldier or whatever. But even for them, you know, story can make that whole experience. If you just like running around shooting a gun, but if there's a story to it, that can even make it more compelling.
Yeah, that's the reason why there's a rise in games that are primarily story-based.
Yeah.
Like,
even in genres that didn't traditionally have it.
Yeah. Like, the disappearance of Ethan Carter. Or, most recently, Everyone Goes to the Rapture. Where you are walking through this, town in the UK, and you're trying to find out what happened to everybody, and there are these ghostly lights that fly around, and you can see past events. They show you past events, show you what people are saying, and you try to piece together the mystery of what happened that caused all this. And there's no combat, there's no, there's puzzle solving, and there's no combat.
But see, the thing is, these large companies like EA and them don't have time to sit down and tell a story.
No.
And, I mean, people can really get crazy with stories. I mean, there are whole websites dedicated to, like, the Elder Scrolls games.
to just dedicate it to the just insane amount of backstory.
Shoddy cast.
Yeah, there's a whole series of videos about this, not even about the game, but about the world in which you participate in.
I think it's the lore in Elder Scrolls and the Fallout series is so vast that they can create long-running shows that cover it, and there's still more to talk about.
There's still more to talk about, because they've created worlds that are deeper, more involved. They've sat down, and they didn't just write a game. They wrote a story, and they wrote a world. They wrote this environment, this universe that exists, and whenever you get to play a game, you play as a piece of that universe. You actually are a part of something bigger that has a history and has a future, and that what you do sort of matters in the overall arc of what happens in the existence in this world within the defined parameters of that game.
Yeah.
You feel like it matters, and that this, you learn to care about this world. You learn to care about its characters and its places and its people.
Yeah. They started out small. Shoddycast started out really small. And then
it was amazing to watch those guys evolve.
Oh God, yes. Then they did a Patreon page, and people started donating to them. And now they've got several voice actors working for them now.
Yeah, I like what they did. I like what they did.
And they've done an incredible job.
Yeah, it's good work.
Yeah. And
but you'll never see it from EA?
No. You'll never
That's the thing. You'll never see
EA, Activision.
I know we're kind of sound like we're picking on EA, but a lot
you
of the
really
other...
are, because EA used to be the complete opposite of what they are today.
They really are. We're really kind of sounds like we're picking on them. It's kind of across the board, but they are the most up there. The most they're the prime example of the of this type of laser rot that's going on in the game industry.
Because you and me, we grew up in the 80s. I was born in 69, and I was raised through the 70s. I remember Sonny and Cher on TV.
That's
on primetime TV.
That's before my time.
Yeah, I remember Sonny and Cher being on TV. I remember watching them on TV. Then the Atari 2600 came out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I played it on a black and white television.
I have moved forward.
And we both saw the video game crash of 83.
I was still pretty young at that point.
You were still pretty young. I noticed it. I remember going to KB Toys in Fairlane Mall in Detroit, Michigan, and I remember seeing these huge bins, and they were filled with these games, and they had the most uninteresting looking box art.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them didn't even have box art. Some of them just had a screen capture of the game on them. And just a small blurb on the back. And they were in there for $1.
Mm-hmm.
And they weren't selling. And they were just piles of them.
I think I think when we talk about a game crash in what's coming, I think it's going to be of a different nature than the old 80s one.
Yes, that was a complete collapse.
That was a complete collapse because you didn't have an internet to kind of ride on the side of that. And I think when you talk about a game crash, what we're talking about is failure of the large corporation style, EA style companies.
Mm-hmm.
You're talking about them basically falling on their face. Yeah.
And interesting enough, Electronic Arts and Activision were two of the biggest survivors of that crash.
Yeah.
They moved to computers. They moved to the Commodore 64 and other competing computer systems at that time.
Yeah. And so I think the nature of this crash will be different. I don't think we're going to have such a vivisection of the gaming world.
No.
That'll occur. It won't be as vivisecting, but what'll happen is I think where you'll see the biggest impact is I think for console users. I think the PC will almost always I can almost see them surviving pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
I see the PC market pretty much suffering a lot more deeper, and I think Nintendo will probably be one of the earliest victims of this.
You mean the console market?
Well, the console market, that's what I meant.
Yeah.
The console market, and I think Nintendo will probably be one of the first victims. Because they've already poorly positioned themselves moving forward. That I think they're not going to be able to keep up as easily because of the way they've done their stuff. And I think Sony and Microsoft to be kind of in a race to see who kind of gets out of it first.
Yeah.
Because developers will be just so uninterested because they won't be able to sell units. I think because, you know, there'll be disinterest in it. I think the PC will almost always survive it, though. People, there'll still be people who buy games, but I don't think it'll be in the same nature of it. But I think definitely the companies are going to reevaluate what they put out in a big way.
You're starting to see a little bit of some of that starting to happen on a small scale.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now what's happening is you're starting to see a gap between what game reviewers are saying about a game, mm-hmm. and what the users are saying about it. The scores that the journalists are giving it and what the users are saying about mm-hmm. the game. You're seeing a big difference.
Yeah.
Starting to happen. And what's going on is these companies are gaming the system. They're gaming the review system.
Mm-hmm.
Where they are imposing...
paying the reviewers and stuff. Maybe not all of them, but there's probably some of that going on.
Not just paying them. What they're doing is they're advertising with their companies like GameSpot or IGN or Machinima. They're advertising with them on their site. And...
don't want to hurt your advertising revenue.
They don't want to hurt their advertising revenue, so they give these games
good
reviews.
They're paying them. That's what it comes down to, is they're paying them, roundabout way.
If you give their games good reviews, they'll give you review copies. If you don't, you don't get review copies like what happened with Jim
mm-hmm.
Sterling. You know, and he's happy with not getting review copies. I mean, he sees it as a badge of honor that he's being blacklisted by a lot of companies because he tells it like it is.
Yeah. If the game sucks, the game sucks. Quit making crappy crap.
And these things of, like, game developers are doing these review embargoes where you're not allowed, or you're only allowed to show certain things, or you're not allowed to talk about the game or review the game until after it launches, or just before it launches, and all these things. And it's like, if you don't have that kind of confidence in your game, if it's that bad, then if you're imposing an embargo on reviews,
you know your game sucks.
You know your game sucks.
You know your game sucks. That's what it is. You know your game is crap from the get-go.
Yeah.
And so if you know your game is crap, this is a sign of exactly what we're talking about. The crash is coming. Because mm-hmm. if you know you're putting out crap, then you know that, you know, there's the old saying, what you put out, you get back.
Mm-hmm.
And you're eventually... people are going to look at this crap and go, we don't want to buy this no more. We're done buying this.
Yeah, or the other thing that companies will do is that they'll invite a journalist out to either the studio or to some kind of rented apartment or rented hotel room,
yeah.
rented space, and then they'll have the game designer sitting there and guiding them through their experience playing the game
mm-hmm.
to make sure that they don't go
trip over something and go the wrong way.
Trip over something, and they'll have them play the most polished levels of the game.
Mm-hmm.
They'll give them a couple of hours or a couple of days with the game in a certain area. They won't let them explore certain things.
But all this shows is how much the game is broken and how much it's not ready to be polished. It's not ready to go. And they're just whitewashing it. And mm-hmm. this is exactly the kind of snafu that is going to create, that is creating, I really should say it in the present tense,
mm-hmm.
is it is in the present tense, that is creating this angst, this kind of irritation and kind of anger among the fan base of these genres and games of saying, look, I'm getting tired of this.
Mm-hmm.
There's got to come a point where they're just gonna like, we're not buying this no more. We don't want it. We're not even gonna put the money. I'm gonna put my money in something that I know is good.
Yeah.
And what's happening is at the same time they're doing what you're talking about, you've got these little independent companies writing these games that are incredibly good.
Mm-hmm.
So when we really talk about gaming crash, we're really talking about gaming crashing of the large corporations.
Yes, the big AAA studio.
Yeah, we're talking about, and the thing is, everyone's, you know, the media mostly is going to totally flip out,
mm-hmm.
and then all that's going to do is just make it, it's drama, and they're not in the middle of it, so they're going to be like, oh, look at this, gaming crashing, and all this other stuff, and it's going to be all this drama, which is going to drive it up even more, because they're going to be wanting their ratings,
And so they're gonna pound that nail into the coffin, and it's gonna just hurt the gaming community overall. You know, it's like, well, games crash. Nobody wants to buy games, and then, you know, next version of the consoles don't sell, next copies of games don't sell, and, you know, some people get the weird idea, well, it must be all games. They don't buy, you know, it hurts independent developers because they're like, we're just making our game. Our game's pretty good, and, you know, we've had good reviews, and yet nobody buys it because nobody wants to buy any game at all because they think because the big companies fail, they think it's everybody.
And then PC gaming inherits the earth.
Yeah. Because without the console sales, you're not gonna see much more console work. I honestly think we're getting close to the end of the console eras anyway. I think that really is transitioning away. The line between a PC and a console is so dang thin right now that it's not even remotely funny anymore.
We recently bought all three consoles. We got the Wii U there. We got the X-Bone and the PS4.
Right.
And the Xbox One and PS4 are both x86 machines.
Yeah, there's not much. I mean, the only real advantage to them is it's easier to hook up the controller, and it's designed to work with, you know, to be sat in the living room and play. Mm-hmm. But honestly, it doesn't take much to take any old PC and sort of do the same thing. I mean, Steam's got their interface now for that, and there's others. You know, honestly, some of these game companies would be better served by just selling cheaper PCs that you could use in general purpose. You hook it to your TV and put it in game mode.
Yeah.
Or just have you buy a laptop that features the Microsoft UI, and when the lid's closed and whatnot, and it's turned off for all the other operating system stuff, you punch a button and you just plug your HDMI cable in, and it's in game mode, and it just has a gaming interface with all the games you have on board.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, you open it up, and there they are as regular installed games. I mean, Microsoft kind of ahead of everybody. They're kind of trying to do that a little bit. They're kind of heading in that direction a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Microsoft's kind of ahead of the game on that just a little bit.
That's a little bit.
I think Steam's out a little bit ahead of them by just a notch. But Microsoft's not far behind. I think they're not implementing it in a great way because they're doing some other stupid stuff along with it.
Mm-hmm.
If they would throw out the stupid crap, they've got a good idea.
Yeah. I played a whole bunch of the Master Chief Collection. I'd never played Halo 2 before. I played Halo 1 on the PC. Never played Halo 2. Never got it on the PC because it required Vista to play. And I didn't have Vista at the time, and because it was a DirectX 10 only game.
Then you got Vista, then you wish you hadn't.
God, Vista was awful.
That's another story there. That's
another story. But and then I started playing Halo 3. I haven't finished all the way through that yet. I thought of trying to see if I could play it on here using that streaming function, seeing what it might be.
Well, we have a fast enough network. Yeah,
we got a gigabit network with enterprise grade switches. So. Yeah. That should.
Yes, I know, because all the cords are on the wrong side of the machine.
Yeah, so that should work. That should definitely work for us. And playing it, I still realize, you know, I still want a keyboard and mouse for a first-person shooter.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay. You know what it is? The difference between games on PC and games on console is that the console games are all about the spectacle.
Mm-hmm.
All about being flashy and big explosions. It's like a difference.
I think this is true for games in general, for certain types of games.
Yeah, it's like difference. It's like a difference between watching a Michael Bay film and a James Cameron movie.
Well, I think what it is, especially when you get the home console system, by default, you know, the idea is they're supposed to always work, they shouldn't crash, because they're on console. Of course, that's becoming a little loose these days. Yeah, I know. And, once upon a time, it was like, if it got released, and it wasn't good, it crashed, it was a bad game. But you didn't want to ever touch it again, because, you know, well, anyway. Oh,
these new consoles crash.
But, you know, you hook it into, you know, well, that's because the way things are done. That's because they're not consoles anymore. They're PCs in a box. But anyway,
But what I'm getting to is that, you know, it's easier to hook them to your sound system. The games have expected and provided specifications. The game is tuned for it, at least should be, so that, you know, you have a set experience.
Mm-hmm.
Where on PC, when somebody builds their own machine, any variety of possible combinations of hardware and software, you know, what can be running at the same time and stuff like that. So, I mean, that's about the only real difference between them. And you get down to the experience, and, you know, they can, you know, do certain things on. But here's my big thing. When you talk about console keyboard versus controller.
Mm-hmm.
Take, for example, me and my brother had this problem. My brothers have grown up on console. They've mm-hmm. never played, I think it was, I think most of their games were like Call of Duty style games and stuff,
mm-hmm.
but they played on console. They were used to console. They were used to a controller. They, when I told them that I like to play first person shooter with a keyboard and mouse, they looked at me kind of funky eyed and kind of like blank looked like, how can you play a first-person shooter without a controller? And I'm like, watch this. And I'm, you know, I opened my laptop and I whipped out a game and just sat there on my laptop and played a little bit of Unreal Tournament, and they couldn't figure it out. Where, you know, I get on the console and I can't shoot worth a flip because I need a mouse to target with. Mm-hmm. And what's happened is you get this little bit of schism, just, you were trained on a system, you learned the system, and you're kind of accustomed to it.
Mm-hmm.
They always grew up with a console, with a key, with a controller, rather, and that's what they know. And so their mind, and then being able to interact with that world, they're tuned to it. Where me, I'm like, I can't do first-person shooter with a controller. I need a mouse. So I think that there is one of the key things that, you know, is kind of helping consoles, that people are like, I don't know how to play on a computer. How do I even aim? You know, the mouse feels clunky compared to my little thumbstick, which I can, you know, point and shoot just fine. You know, there's a little bit of that. And I had that experience with my brothers, and it kind of enlightened me to that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
That people don't realize, you know, when you've grown up on those consoles, growing up, you're used to that stick, or those dual analog sticks or whatever, and you can't shoot straight with a keyboard and mouse. Just like someone who's been playing keyboard and mouse for years and shooters can't shoot straight with a controller to save their soul. I mean, they can, but it's another easier and harder ways of going about it.
Yeah. I have noticed also in watching, I'm subscribed to a channel called Top Hats and Champagne. And Top Hats and Champagne is a PC Master Race channel. And it's a PC Master Race satire channel where it satirizes the whole fight between console and PC users.
Like I said, today it's kind of almost moot because they're kind of PCs in a box, but anyway.
Yeah. And I don't remember if he's French or German. I think he's French. But he recently moved to Australia. And he does these shows where he picks apart quotes from console peasants, and he does the same thing for PC users who go way out in their comments. And he started one recently on journalists that just don't get the industry and and everything. And I also watch Jimquisition, Jim Sterling, and he's talked about this a lot, and it came up big time with a game called Aliens Colonial Marines.
I've never seen that one.
You're lucky.
I'm not missing anything, huh?
Yeah. Basically, in this subject, this part, the finished product is not matching the previews.
Oh, I've seen that before. Spore.
Yeah, Spore.
Spore.
That's another problem. Basically, what happened was, I forget what E3 it was. I think it was the 2012 E3.
Somewhere in there.
Well, they had this big showing of the game. And it was a scene where you were walking through a, hangar, and you got into a loader, like the one from the film Aliens, and it was really well done, and the game looked awesome.
It's probably because it was all pre-rendered. You might have been.
Probably pre-done. It moved really smooth. Way too smooth to look like it was gameplay.
Probably was pre-rendered.
And when the game launched, it was the most horrendously buggy mess you've ever seen. I mean, Angry Joe was just beside himself when he did his review of the game.
Angry Joe was extra angry, huh?
Oh, God, he was pissed off. I watch his show. I have never seen him.
Okay. I'm just
destroying the room.
Destroying the room.
He was pissed. I've never seen Angry Joe this mad before. I mean, he's usually angry because he's Angry Joe.
Angry for Angry Joe.
But I've never seen him this pissed. And Jim Sterling just had... He just burned them for this. Where... The game that came out was nothing like what was shown. And of course, you know, that was pretty early in development. But the AI was awful. You had the aliens that were just doing inexplicable things. I mean, there's a joke video where the aliens just moving, dancing around. And then you have an old, you have an audio clip playing from the old, Looney Tunes cartoons with the frog. You know, the dancing frog from the Looney Tunes cartoon? remember when it would dance for this one guy, but whenever anyone was looking, it would just sit there and go... Burr, burr.
Yes, I remember that. I actually remember this. Yes.
Did a video of that where this alien is just doing this with that music. And the whole game is like that. I mean, it is awful. And... The developer,
you've already paid for it by buying it to find that out.
I didn't buy the game. I saw Angry Joe's review.
People bought the game not knowing.
I know, people bought the game, and Steam reviews were not a thing then.
Mm-hmm.
And so people couldn't get their money back. A few people were able to, but back then you could only get one refund in your entire lifetime, your account. And it was awful.
I think it needs to be the thing. If the system you're buying a game through, if these games are truly copy protected, then why can't we have a refund systems need to be a thing, where if a game sucks, you know, it's one thing that, you know, you've played it for 6 months and you want a refund. No, you've been playing it for 6 months. You obviously liked it. But if a couple of days after buying the game, it sucks and you're like, I'm giving this back. I want my money back for it.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
And Spore was the same problem, where what we were shown was not what we got.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, what he showed, literally, there were, in some of the graphics that he showed, there were creatures with multi-tiered skeleton systems, where it was branching off and everything, and there was, like, a water level and all this other stuff. They never added the water environment. Mm-mm. They never added the multi-bone structure. It was, and nowadays, by the way... Now, the online portion of it no longer works because, well, Axis is gone.
Yeah.
They so, all the assets and stuff, you can't... I mean, the game nowadays is broken.
Yeah. I mean, I have it. I bought it.
I enjoyed what there was when I played it. I thought it was... I thought it was nice, but at the same time, it was like... It was not what it was supposed to be. There was so... I remember people being so hyped about this game. And I remember having such great expectations for it. And there were so many funny elements to it when what he showed us. And then what we got was like...
Eh.
Yeah, what happened? I mean, it was a little more polished looking, which was okay.
Yeah.
But where's the rest of the game? The content was missing.
Yeah. I mean, that whole aquatic... You know, right after the single cell organism.
There was supposed to be an aquatic level.
Yeah, an aquatic level, and that was gone.
It was totally gone. They didn't put it in the aquatic level. And then there was a lot of other elements of development that it just was like, what are they doing?
Yeah, I mean, it...
And creature development that never was implemented, that was in the videos he showed, development of, you know, multiple, you know, skeletal components and stuff, like, completely missing.
I tried to create complex bodied creatures and I just couldn't.
You can
to a certain degree, but it doesn't work perfectly.
Yeah, well, after a certain point they start kind of like freaking out.
You know, it just didn't work right. And nowhere near what was
it promised. was not what it should have been.
And Will Wright is no longer in the gaming industry because of that. Well, he is sort of, kind of. He's an advisor now. Does stuff more for education than he does for
games. I really kind of wish somebody would pick up the mantle of what he left there and kind of run with it, because I still would like to have a game like that. A proper one. I mean, one where, you know, where the creatures are... I mean, literally, the creatures had, like, little DNA files. What was amazing about that game was the photos of your creature contained the DNA.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a PCX file or something? It was a picture file. But the picture file was the save file, so you'd have a graphic of your critter, and it was like a little 16K file. And that was the creature.
Yeah.
That was it. And it would load up into the game, and that would be him.
It utilized the unused space in the game to store code.
Or unused space in the image.
In the image to store code to reassemble your creature.
And the creatures were all, you know, the whole game was procedurally rendered. The whole game was procedurally regenerated environment.
Even the music.
Everything was. And it was an amazing game. And I just wish that it could have been more, nothing on what he did. I wanted what he showed. And there was one point, this amazed me. There was one point in one of his demos, he said, this game is rough beta. It is basically scotch tape and baling wire holding this thing together right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it was better than what we got.
Yeah.
He called it scotch tape and baling wire working, and yet it was better than what we played.
Mm-hmm.
At least that's what it looked like to me.
Oh, it looked so much better than what we got. What we got was kiddified. Was basically that turned into a casual game.
Yeah.
And then they did Darkspore.
So stupid. That was where they did not understand. That was the sad part where they didn't understand. And I think that point, that they do not understand. They did not understand what he had created. He had created something totally new. It was innovative. It had never been done before in that way. And they didn't get it.
Yeah.
I mean, it literally would have been the birth of a new genre. And they didn't get it. And this is why they're going to fail eventually, because they don't get it. They don't get what people really want from a game. They don't get that people are okay with a longer development cycle if it produces better games. I mean, I don't mind waiting a year or two for a game if I know that when I get it, it's going to be polished, the story is going to be spot on, the control systems are going to be excellent, that they've done their research, they've done the time to, you know, put the whole thing together right. These things are complex pieces of software. They are very complex pieces of software. It takes time to get it right. And, you know, that's why, you know, you have these projects that are coming out on these crowdfunded source games. They're taking time to make because they're doing it right.
Yeah.
Because it takes time to write a piece of software.
I say they delayed the first-person shooter component for Star Citizen because the first iteration was not working right. So they pulled it and to work on it some more.
Yeah. And that's okay if they're like, yeah, we got it that this didn't come out the way we wanted. We're going to send it back. We're going to work on it. We're going to get it right. We're going to put it back out there correct.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like, that's what needs to be done. It's okay that if something takes a long time. And I think that's the problem with this industry. And the problem is, if they don't put out something every 6 months and they're spending millions and millions and millions of dollars on it, if they don't make that money back, they're having negative cash flow.
Mm-hmm.
What's going to happen when you have too many negative cash flows? Too far apart.
Mm-hmm.
You start losing money. Then you can't afford people. And then you start collapsing because you can't maintain it.
Mm-hmm.
What makes them think they can maintain it now? I don't know. Because that's going to happen is they're going to start getting negative cash flows because they're going to spend millions and millions of dollars on a game. And they're going to have a game that's just literally going to bomb. And it's going to kill them. It's going to hurt their budget. And they're going to be like, well, oh, that didn't work. And then stop making it altogether.
I think the death of SimCity and the slow lingering death of The Sims is not the thing that's going to hurt EA in the long run, because those had
those their are bellwethers audience. Of the overarching problem, though.
Yeah, those are built, you know, what you said, bellwethers of the overarching problem, but they weren't big flagship titles.
They're coming, though.
And that's going to happen to their next games.
Yeah. I mean, you're going to see small little things like that that they own peel off, and then you're going to get it down to the core of the company, and then you're going to have all it's going to take is one major failure, like you said, one failure from falling,
I think what's going to happen. I think that's going to happen with Star Wars Battlefront. A lot of the stuff that I've been seeing out of that,
That's not out yet, is it?
No, it's not out yet. I may not get it. There's no space combat. It's just a lot of the decisions that they're making with that game is just,
you know, and I remember you and me sitting down and playing an earlier Battlefront on the old PS2, and I had a lot of fun because I loved that Battleroid, those ones that roll around and
Droidica.
Droidicas, yeah, I'm sure I remember their name. Those Droidica ones.
Yeah.
And I remember just sitting there and camping you out with that sucker and rolling around and blasting you with it. And I had fun. And what happened when I looked at the next Battlefront game that they had after that? Where was the Droidica? I'm like, that's what I love playing. Why don't I even want to continue with this? That was my favorite thing to play.
You could play it, but you had to wait until your group had accrued enough points.
See, that's stupid. It's like, why? It's like, why couldn't there have been just an open mode where I could just go and play it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, locking content like that, I've never been a fan of that. It's one thing to lock up to the next weapon or the next level of stuff, but something like that, especially when it was already available in the earlier one.
Like with Mario Maker, it'll take 9 days to unlock all the tools, but at least you don't have to buy them.
Just buy the game and let it sit for a week.
Well, you have to play it to unlock them.
Well, I can kind of understand where they're kind of coming from on that one, just a wee bit, in that they're like, learn how to do it first before we overwhelm you with all the crap. Because I think what I saw there was the menu system had a lot of items in it.
Yeah, it was a lot. They didn't want to overwhelm you.
I think that was the thing that I was getting, is they did not want it to look overwhelming.
Yeah.
Because I bet you, dollars to biscuits, they did usability studies, and one of the complaints was, there's too much stuff.
Yeah.
Initially, starting out. Then after people pay for a while, they're like, oh, well, I can handle this now. So they handled that by saying, okay, well, we're going to let you get into it slowly and let you play it for a while with it not be overwhelming. And then as you're, you know, playing it and unlocking it, you get more stuff slowly over time so that, but you're not buying it.
You know what Nintendo is very good at that a lot of other companies are not?
What's that?
That is, they are good at showing you what the game is going to look like when you get it. When you finally get it. What they show you is what you'll get.
Yeah.
That's what they're very good at. And nowadays, that's not happening. With, you know, these...
You see all these promos and you never really see gameplay.
Yeah.
And I don't think we saw gameplay of, like, the sky and whatnot flying in Final Fantasy for quite a while.
Yeah, and the marketing just never reflects the actual finished product.
Yeah. But all that says is they don't believe in their own product. I mean, if they don't believe in it, why should we?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a key statement right there. If they don't believe in it, why should we?
Now, Dave Williams, who wrote the article on crack.com, he says that 80% of the work in the game is done in 20% of the schedule. At the last 20%.
That's possible. You're trying to get everything all polished together, and assembling all your assets and stuff. Yeah. Getting it all kind of finally assembled, because there's a lot of the creation of the artwork, creation of the animation, the storyboarding, level designs, you know, where you're kind of, you know, laying it all out, and then you got to put it all together at the end.
Yeah.
You know, once the guys are with the engine are done and the tools are built, and you can start putting all your animations and everything all together.
I think some of the problems with these early games for the new consoles, the consoles are capable of 1080p. It's just a lot of the games aren't. They're not reaching 1080p, or what they do, they can't get over 30 frames per second.
They're not optimizing the scenes.
Not optimizing the scenes. What is a lot of development on new hardware happens before even the hardware is out. They'll develop for new hardware without really knowing what the hardware is capable of.
Yeah.
That happens a lot with games that are being targeted for a new kind of GPU architecture on PC.
Mm-hmm.
And then it comes out, And then all of a sudden you have to have all these patches.
Because it wasn't optimized in the way that it needed to be.
Yeah.
Especially when you're dealing with low-level hardware like that. You know, being an application programmer, used to do assembly language, I know that understanding your hardware was key. You had to know your hardware. If you didn't know your hardware, you couldn't do jack. You couldn't optimize well.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have an unfinished piece of hardware and they're just giving you specs of what they want versus what you wind up getting, you know, that's a different story. Or what they say it is capable of, and you discover in usage, and here's where it comes from. They give you a spec sheet and say, it could be this, or mm-hmm. it's supposed to be this. When you go to use it, when you finally get it, you find out that it doesn't match those specs. It doesn't perform in the way that, or there's other optimizations that you completely missed, or total functions don't work like they're supposed to, or as documented, or, you know, it goes left, it should have went right, mm-hmm. or, you know, optimizations you discover after the fact. But, you know, that's after everything's all assembled and ready to be shipped out the door.
Yeah.
And that don't help.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think we're heading for a crash of some kind. I'm not sure the exact shape it'll take. And the question would be, who will be the first victim? We're looking at UEA. But everyone's kind of expecting EA to be the first. It may not be. But
yeah, we really pick on them because they've changed the most from what they used to be.
Yeah, they used to be very respectable. The game company by gamers, and they're not. They're a game company ran by corporation, corporate people, and they don't know nothing about gaming.
There'll be people out there who will disagree with this statement I'm about to make. They have to deal with it because it's true. Video games are art.
No, well, that's a given. For me personally, that's a given.
You know, video games are an art form. And if you go into art with the express purpose of you're going to make this to make money, you're not going to succeed because you're just doing it to make money. You're not doing it because you're passionate about it. People.
This is true for music and a lot of anything that's art.
Yes. Because people can tell if you made something just to make money or if you made something because you're passionate about it.
I actually think this is the most important point.
Right? And they'll say, and people will say, well, they're a company. They're supposed to be making money. That's what they're there for. Let's say,
yeah. That's fine.
But. You can't treat games that way.
It's okay to make money off of what you love to do.
Yeah.
That's the point though.
Mm-hmm.
You make money off of what you love to do. That comes first. The passion comes first for the game.
Mm-hmm.
The passion for writing the best games and enjoying that and doing it because you love it, not because you want to make money, but because you enjoy making games. You enjoy telling stories. You're an artist and you like to be creative and like to do this stuff. And you, the fact that people, you would do it just because if nobody else cared. And making money is just cream on top of that. And you make a living off of doing what you enjoy. Many of these game companies have lost that.
Yeah.
They do it because they're in it to make money, make profit, to keep Wall Street happy, rather than the gamers happy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where they're going to fail.
And it shows.
In the product. It's art, and we can tell when it looks like an apple or a pile of crap. We can tell the difference.
Mm-hmm. But you can see Colossal Order was passionate about the game they were making.
Yes. They were. You could tell. And it's all in the game. And the game had bugs and the reissues. Yeah. But you could tell that every bit of that game was meant for the city simming enthusiast. Yeah.
And with CD Projekt Red, you can tell that they were passionate about making this game. They're making The Witcher 3.
Yeah.
Because there is so much rich detail to that game.
You can tell they went out of their way to make it the best game they possibly could.
They went out of their way to make it the best game they could. In Skyrim, you go into a town, and it's supposed to be this big city, but it's this real small place, and there aren't really any homes. There's like shops, and there's maybe a few small houses, but there's more NPCs walking around, Final Fantasy XI was bad for this, where they had this big city, but there weren't any homes.
Well, the idea was you just weren't seeing it.
Yeah, well, yeah, the idea is you weren't seeing it. But you go into these cities that are supposed to be cities, and there are all these NPCs walking around living in these towns. It's been true
for video games for a long time,
though. It's been true for video games for a long time. All these NPCs walking around, but where are their homes? Where do they live?
Skyrim, they did have some homes. Or not Skyrim, but, what do you call it, well, what it is it's the token city.
Yeah, the
token
city.
It's the token city. It represents the village. Because, honestly, there's not enough people in that world total to maintain the population of that world. Sorry.
I know. But I went into Novigrad in The Witcher 3, which is one of the first areas after the beginning area of the game that you go into. And it's this vast area, and it is much larger than Skyrim. In this one zone. And this is just one of the zones that you can explore. I go into this city and I go, this is what a city in a game is supposed to look like. This is a city. This place is huge. I got lost. And there are people's homes and there's stuff happening on the streets, and these children running around, playing tag, and singing songs, and these men working on the street, and women walking around and chatting. It's like, there is rich detail here, and it looks like a old medieval Eastern European city.
They went out of their way to make it a rich experience. Even the little things mattered to them.
Yes.
That was the thing. The little things mattered to them. And so you could tell that they spent a lot of time and a lot of effort in even detail that you may not see, but for 20 seconds as you walk past it. The fact that it was there, that somebody spent time designing, developing, implementing that there, that little tiny piece. You know, writing that song, having that kid play, having whatever it was that somebody, they actually put the time in to flesh out that detail, to make it a rich experience. Even beyond just the normal, what you would see in a game world, that they went out of their way to add detail.
I mean, even in Skyrim, I was being a little hard on Skyrim there.
Yeah, a little bit. Skyrim, that's a token city.
Skyrim is very good, too. Yeah. I mean, there's a high level of detail there, also. If you look at some items have this incredible level of detail, and you hardly ever notice it.
But they went out of their way to even add more, to take it to the next level.
Yeah.
You know.
There's just so much to say about what's going on in the industry. And there are so many signs pointing to where things are going. Where things are headed. So many signs. Biggest, I think, also is that it's a very exploitive industry. Because I have heard a lot of horror stories about, and again, we're going to pick on EA some more.
That's so much fun.
You know, they're our favorite whipping boy. That they have, you know, almost sweatshop-like conditions for their developers. They get short breaks, almost sometimes no breaks, 60 to 80 hour work weeks.
I want to pause it there anyway and just kind of recut it. Just kind of stop that file.
Well, I'll just edit this portion out.
Just make sure you know where it's at.
Yeah.
Put a tag in there or something. Anyway.
Okay. But it's a, you know, they have 60 to 80 hour work weeks. And it's very stressful, and a lot of the veterans are being driven away.
Well, nobody wouldn't work under those conditions.
Yeah, nobody's wanting to work under those conditions, and they're losing a lot of their talent, but they're getting a lot of these young, fresh-faced developers in.
Mostly for the hours of experience, just to be able to have some experience under their belt when they sign up for a better company.
Yeah. And they got, you know, burnout is pretty high.
Well, then they are definitely going down then. Because, I mean, if you have a working environment like that, it's not going to last long. Especially when you're trying to make some... You cannot have a depressed, repressed environment and try to write something fun.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot do that. You cannot create art, entertainment through this sort of brutality. You'll fail.
Yeah.
They're headed toward that. If that's their working conditions, then yeah, they're in trouble. They're in deep, deep trouble.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And a lot of people working in the industry around their 20s and 30s, they're wanting to try and start a family. And they're wanting something a little more stable because, you know, developers get laid off from a company immediately after the game launches or sometime after.
Mm-hmm.
Unless in their
project or something that they can jump them to or something.
No, another project they can jump onto, or in their contract they stick around to work on DLC.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. And experienced talent leaving the industry, and they're bringing in inexperienced people and businessmen and lawyers in to run the companies.
Yeah.
And it's showing. No, the artists, they're still sticking around. I mean, people who have very specialized skills, you know, who know how to do proper jiggle figure. God.
Jiggle physics. Jiggle figure. Well, I guess improper jiggle figure gets you a singing toad.
And that's the level of professionalism you get on this show, folks. You know, people who can do jiggle physics.
Every time you say that, I think of a dancing toad now.
But people like that are sticking around. But a lot of their experienced people are leaving. Like Cliff Blazinski. He left Epic and started his own company.
I think a lot of them are doing it because they know they can do more of what they want to do, their own artwork.
Yeah.
I think that's the thing about the companies, the kind of environment they create. That creates your retainability. If, you know, where I used to work, you know, when I first started, it was enjoyable. I liked what I did.
Mm-hmm.
But by the time I left, the corporate mentality had so taken over that I'm like, this is not fun to work here anymore. I'm out.
Yeah. I mean, they weren't interested in...
Nobody was interested in the opinion.
You had a new way of doing assembler programming that would have made their lives so much better.
Oh,
so much easier, and they didn't want it.
I was able to... I think I broke... Because of the way they were doing it, they had all kinds of crazy restrictions on how the size of the program could be, the flexibility of the program, the kind of different stuff they could do. And I took IBM's macro language and I expanded it with my own macros and created a system that broke all those rules where you could have virtually unlimited size application or, you know, whatever, how much data and how much structure you could even possibly want. And I was willing to help teach them to do it. And they were not interested. And the thing is, they told us they had this big honking deal about creating reusable code. And I had modules that I would load into every project all the time. And where it was all reusable, totally reusable, libraries of subroutines, and complete disinterest. And in fact, they told me not to do it because they were too worried about having to teach the ready-to-be-retired programmers something new. And mm-hmm. then that was basically the beginning of the end for me.
Yeah. Oh, and there was somebody that made the statement of saying that, we know about this is legacy. We don't care about that.
Yeah, there was that. There was that statement. We know it was the legacy thing. We don't care about legacy. All we want is the new stuff. And it was like, oh, well, legacy's all fine and all that. I don't mind, you know, something new. But if you don't have a transition period, you're screwed. And they didn't want a transition period. They didn't want to do anything. They just want to just completely, you know, we're just going to create something new and just throw the old stuff out without any transitioning. And we don't want any input from anybody about what was going on prior. No input.
Oh, and did they ever finally give up on trying to do that one program with nothing but SQL?
No, they were going ahead with it. they were going ahead with it, and so it's like, okay.
They ever make it work?
No. Let's put it this way. They stopped by my... When I finally talked to my manager about it, I don't really want to say who I was working for in this, too, so yeah. I'm going to be careful what I'm saying about this. But basically what it came down to was me sitting in my manager's, or sitting in my former manager's office, and I actually went down there deliberately to ask about this. I said, are they still attempting to do this just with SQL? And he said, yes. And I said, I wrote the program originally. That's not really possible. And he said, well, they're doing it. And I said, yeah, but how much SQL? He said, I think it was like 900 pages worth of SQL to do this. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding. It's going to take this thing. And I'm like, this is silly. And he says, no, it's not. I said, this is not optimized. And he just was like, look, I know. I agree with you. This isn't me choosing this. This is a frontline manager. Mm-hmm. And he said, I agree with you. But it doesn't matter. It came down from on high. It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
They told us to do this, so we're doing it. Whether regardless of whether it'll work or not, whether it's optimized or not, they told us to do it. I'm like, okay. And he said, well, it's not me. I said, I feel sorry for it. And he said, so do I. And that was it. That was it. And I don't want to say much more than that, but it was that's one of the reasons I was like, I'm out of here.
The only thing we'll say is that this wasn't private sector.
No, this was not private sector. No. But anyway, I don't want to say much more than that, though.
Yeah.
I don't get myself in any kind of trouble.
No.
But it was screwed up in that kind of way. And the point is that the corporate mentality coming down and telling the programmers how to do their job when the programmers know that this is not a good way to do it is the key point to this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
Is the, that, you know, these people coming from in on high with their college degrees and all this expertise come in and dictate how to do everything, micromanage everything. And it's like, when the programmers know this is not a good way to do this, and they say, no, you're doing it anyway. Mm-hmm. We know, you know, when you look at your managers and you look at your bosses and your team leaders or however it's organized, whatever company you're in, and they're like, we know, we agree with you, this is screwed up, and they're making us do it anyway.
Yeah.
That kind of mentality, you're just destined for trouble.
Long and short of it is, games aren't going away.
No, they won't. There's too much other stuff going on to create a complete vacuum. Won't be in the same kind of crash.
The gaming industry is going to look different.
It's going to look very different. Some of the big players are going to be MIA in the future. And I don't know when, but it could be, you know, at any point where some of the tried and true things you think are mainstays, companies you think are mainstays that aren't going anywhere will suddenly vanish.
In the gaming industry, there's no such thing as too big to fail.
Gee, I work for Congress, but sorry, they don't give game companies bailouts.
No. The one company I think might weather it the best is Ubisoft. Ubisoft has been doing a lot of these things that EA does, but not as much. To some extent they have, but I think they've done some boneheaded things. But not to the extent of EA. EA, I think, is going to get hit by this worse. Activision's
going to be
close second.
They're going to be smacked around by it pretty good.
They're going to get smacked about it. If EA doesn't change, if EA doesn't adapt, they're going to be a dinosaur. They're going to be gone.
Yeah, they'll be out of the gaming industry. They'll be doing something else.
Yeah.
One company honestly going away is Epic. I think the fact that they have change the model of how they do things, and the fact that they've got the Unreal Engine, that they're providing technologies for building games more than they are. You know, they're still doing games, but I think they're in the business of providing the platforms for building new games. I think it'll keep them around.
Yeah,
they're gonna weather it pretty good.
Valve,
they're the key to the future.
Valve is doing pretty much a lot of the same thing. They haven't released a new game in a while. They're still working on Dota 2.
Valve has kind of devolved from a gaming company to a distribution platform company.
Yeah.
They're not really making games anymore in the way that they were. I haven't seen a Portal game in a long time. We haven't seen a Half-Life game in a long time. And that's what their signature games were. They've got some other products. But I think they're going to be sort of, they're kind of where EA or kind of where Epic is, but slightly less, because they've got the Source Engine. you know, that people build stuff on top of. And that's going to keep them around. That's going to keep them relevant. They've got the Steam platform. They've transformed themselves from a game company into a technology and distribution company. And I think they're going to stick around. I don't think they're going anywhere. I don't know if you'll see a breakaway from them in any real, because they're one of the better platforms for distribution.
Yeah.
I mean, some people hate them, like them or hate them. They just have a lot of users.
Yeah.
So I don't think they'll go anywhere anytime soon.
They're
not a game company anymore, though.
Steam is DRM, but it's DRM that stays out of your way.
Yeah. It is a DRM system. If there has to be a DRM system, it's probably one of the most manageable DRM systems in existence. It's one of the ones that sort of works.
Yeah.
And it doesn't sit there and up in your face, beat you over the head, you know, kill everything you got. I'm still not a fan of DRM, period. But it's one of the most non-intrusive, you know, ones I've seen.
And of course, there are games on Steam that don't have, that aren't
embedded. That aren't DRM. They don't even have it integrated. Yeah, they don't even have it integrated into
Final Fantasy.
14 doesn't have it integrated.
And
there's a lot of other ones that don't have it integrated.
You can't play the game unless you have a paid account.
That's a whole other form of DRM. Yeah. That's where it's like, we don't care. We don't really care about our software. It's your account that matters.
Yeah.
You know, they prefer you to purchase the client, but you're not really purchasing the client. Where you get the software doesn't really matter. It's you got to have the key on your account that matters, and you buy the key, and that's all that really matters.
Yeah.
Putting a copy of Final Fantasy 14 out there or 11 wouldn't do you an ounce of good without the key tied to your account and for you to be able to log in with. But that only works for MMOs, for a system like that.
Yeah.
Whereas for a single-player game, you have to do something entirely different.
Yeah.
DRM could be its own thing all by itself, too. It's not as big an issue as it once was, I think. The only time it really becomes a huge hairball is when the companies do something boneheaded.
Yeah.
You know, we're looking at UA, SimCity.
Like where you're playing a game.
Or Origin.
Playing the single player game. Your internet goes out, and all of a sudden you get dropped out of the game with an error message saying your internet connection dropped.
That's wrong. That is utterly wrong.
Yeah.
That's a bonehead thing right there. If you want to know what bone, that's an example of a boneheaded thing.
Yeah.
It's one thing if the game sort of signs in once a month and says, hey, am I still legit? Am I still here? You know, or something. I mean, I use the Adobe tool set, for example, the Adobe tools, and it calls home once a month to check my subscription. Cause I have, you know, and sometimes subscription works and sometimes, you know, like the Adobe suite. I use the Creative Cloud for my own editing and stuff like that. And it's $50 a month, and they probably made far more money off me than they would have otherwise. Mm-hmm. But I get every product that they put out practically.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, I can upgrade to all the current stuff, you know, and just download it. And it's like, no problem at all. And it's like, dime in their pocket, you know, it's like, you know, it's $50 a month, but, I'm not trying to advertise from here, but, it's totally, the DRM portion of it is totally out of the way. It's like the only time there's an issue is if it hasn't been able to dial in at the end of the month.
Yeah.
And all that's doing is checking to see if my subscription's been paid.
Yeah.
That's all it is. After that, they totally don't give a hoot.
Mm-hmm. I see, after everything happens, I see smaller teams, smaller budgets. There's still room for big games.
There still is. You'll never see them completely go away. There'll be other companies that survive it pretty well.
And I think you'll see fewer sequels, and what you may see is when you see a big game, you may get more expansions to it.
Yeah. And rather than creating a, well, this is, you know, I'll just give a stupid example. As I can't think of one off the top of my head. Mario. I'm just going to use a stupid example.
Yeah.
Instead of Mario 1, Mario 2, Mario 3, Mario 4, not sequels, but Mario 2, levels 9, Mario 2, level 10, Mario 2, where it's expanding the game, and I can't think of a better example off the top of my head, I don't know why. But, okay, here's like, say, for example, Skyrim. Yeah. Here's a good example.
Mm-hmm.
They haven't put out another, you know, Elder Scrolls game except for ESO. We're not gonna count ESO in this conversation, because that's not the multiplayer. But for a single player game, you have Skyrim.
Mm-hmm.
And what do you have? You have tons of mods and add-ons and all kinds of stuff to go in and enhance that game. I really agree. I think
once a game world has been created in detail, then you just, you know, put on extra, you know, DLC, DLC, DLC. I mean, it's just, it keeps expanding that same story in that same game world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the point where it's like really, really large. And, you know, until the point where it's just almost too large for its own good. But, you know, rather than, you know, the next one, which eventually once you got it so big, okay, you're ready to move on.
Yeah. I think we'll still see sequels.
You'll still see them.
I think, but we won't see the inundation of sequels that we're getting right now.
Yeah.
No. I think also that indie studios will do better than the big studios will.
Long term, they will
survive it. Will
long term, they will. They'll be fine long term. Some of them will get big. What'll happen is you'll have your occasional one hit wonder, or you'll have a company that winds up with somebody like a Shingaru or a whoever, you know, else named, you mm-hmm. know, name or Will Wright or somebody. They'll get somebody on their staff who's like that, mm-hmm. and they'll just create the next, like, oh my god game. And it'll take that company into the stratosphere. They'll redo something. They did it and redo it right, like Colossal Order. And then you'll have this little bitty company, have these little companies turn into big companies. It'll happen. Mm-hmm. They'll grow.
Colossal Order started with 10 people. Now they
I think they're like 200 something. 200? Last time you heard. And the thing is, the question will be, how will they follow, you know, look at EA and look at other large companies and say, what made us a good company? Let's stay with that, mm-hmm. rather than, you know, try to get it rich quick schemes and, you know, kind of methods that EA and them used that failed. EA is a textbook case thing to what not to do in the gaming industry.
I think the key to being successful in the gaming industry, even now, even before the crash happens,
mm-hmm.
which it's going to happen.
But it is.
Before it happens, I think the key to being successful is create games you're passionate about. Create the kind of game that you would love to play.
Mm.
And making money will be a side effect.
Yeah, don't do it because you want to make money. Don't go into it thinking you're going to make. Don't go into it thinking you're going to make money. Don't go into it doing to make money. Always have a backup plan,
mm-hmm.
and always listen to your fans.
Yep.
If you got a fan following, listen to what your fans want. Listen to what they like. Listen to what they didn't like. You know, and then use that as, even if you don't do anything with that particular game, listen to what they said about it and take that as information in making your next game. Take that into account. What did they like? What did they not like? Too many mechanics? Too little mechanics? Too much story? Too little mm-hmm. story? You know, too flary graphics? Too blind graphics? Listen to what they said about it, what their opinions were. The mechanics, the controls, the bug, and then spend more time on that aspect later until you get the formula to where you get this great game that your fans love. You know, whether you're modifying the same game or working on new instances of it, you mm-hmm. know, listen, interact with your fans. Set up blogs, set up forums, you know, set up feeds, you know, do whatever it takes, you know, interact with them. You know, Square does this. They've got forums, they've got live letters, they interact. You actually know you get a better idea of what the developers have in mind.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're learning from that, and they're doing a much better job because they're doing that. And so they're growing, they've made mistakes, they still mm-hmm. probably will, but they're growing and they're making a better game because of it.
I think we'll see more crowdfunding. We'll see
that's
more
coming too.
More openness, more community participation in the development.
That's key, you know. And, you know, it's always got to be some level of management to it, you know, to kind of, when you got a lot of moving parts and a lot of people involved, you got to have, you know, a singular vision.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, make sure that, you know, you're not, keep it all balanced. Keep it all in balance.
Mm-hmm. You're seeing a little bit of this. The Japanese game industry is changing the biggest right now. Because you're seeing a move away from the big companies to where the artists are going off on their own, putting together a team and shipping a game through another company.
Mm-hmm.
That's called the auteur movement. And you're seeing a lot of developers do this. Some of them are going to crowdfunding, mm-hmm. like Shenmue is being funded.
Yeah, that was one. I played one of the early Shenmue. Yeah. I played Shenmue 1, and it was an interesting game.
Yeah, it's being funded partially through crowdfunding. Inafune, the creator of Mega Man, is doing the Mighty Number 9, which is a spiritual successor to Mega Man.
Yeah,
and that's being crowdfunded. And the creator of Castlevania has got a new game coming that's being crowdfunded.
Yeah.
Entirely. Called Bloodstained Symphony of, I forget the name of it.
Yeah. But, people who've been part of the industry who were basically the backbones of where some of these games came from are doing their own thing.
And there's a lot of speculation that after Metal Gear Solid 5 ships, after the Phantom Pain ships, that Kojima could leave Konami and do the same thing.
Well, considering some of the boneheaded stuff Konami's doing, you pretty much can guarantee it. He's probably, I would say it's highly likely. Now, he won't be able to work on Metal Gear anymore, but you'll see him probably start works where he'll do something else and it'll be interesting.
I take a lot of reviews because of what's happening with the review system, I take a lot of reviews with a grain of salt. There are a few that I trust because they're being very open about what the game industry is making them do for these reviews.
Yeah.
And so I saw a review recently. This is going to be his greatest game he's done so far.
Metal Gear Solid 5?
Metal Gear Solid 5. Think Metal Gear mixed with GTA. Big open world, be able to go around, explore, and do things in the game.
Yeah. None of this says that these companies can't make great games, but usually what happens is when you do wind up with one coming out of them, it's usually because you have somebody like Kojima guiding the hand of it.
Yeah.
And how well they're able to get away with it is when, how much control they get over their project and how much interference they're getting from up above.
Yeah. But this is looking to be like his greatest achievement yet.
Which system is coming on?
This is his Spore.
What system is it coming on?
PC and PS4.
That'd be good because I have all the other Metal Gear Solid games.
Yeah, because you can pre-order on Steam now. You can pre-order it, and it looks like it's going to be the best of the series.
Well, if you're
going to
end it well.
Yeah.
I mean, if it's got to end, if the Metal Gear series has got to come to an end, at least end it well.
Well, it's going to be the end with him at the helm, essentially.
They could still do Metal Gear games, but it won't be the same.
It won't be the same. I think he's going to leave the company. There are some people who are saying, oh, no, Kojima and Konami have to kiss and make up.
No, they don't.
And stuff. No, they don't.
No, they don't. He's got enough. When you got skill like that, you can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
Don't think that somebody's tied to a company just because. No. No, no, no. No, 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 no.
No, 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 no.
Because he can go off and do his own thing and make it work well.
Yes, because there have been, instances where that is not true.
Yeah.
Especially for Japanese developers.
Yeah.
Because
there'll be other people who want to snatch them up like bolt of grease lightning.
Because a lot of them, the big ones, have gone off to do their own thing, to do what they want to do, because their company won't let them.
Yeah.
And that's why we're getting a spiritual successor to Castlevania. Mm-hmm. That's why we're getting a spiritual successor to Mega Man. And, all of a sudden, Capcom's starting to do stuff with Mega Man all of a sudden, because this game is getting ready to come out.
Mm-hmm.
And, or it's still in development, it's getting ready to come out. And then Konami.
They may try to make their own Metal Gear without him, and you'll probably notice the difference real fast.
Oh, and then Konami does this thing where they have this racy adult pachinko game with racy adult graphics for Castlevania. Right after this guy, who was the creator of Castlevania, leaves to start and doing his own games.
People
will know the difference.
Yeah. All right.
And we're starting to see something similar to the auteur movement here in the U.S. with game developers, with Blazinski. can't talk. with him from Epic leaving and starting his own company called Boss Key. He's about to show off his first game soon called Blue Streak, which is going to be a Unreal Tournament style game. I understand. Right now, it doesn't look like, a lot of people who aren't paying attention, this is going to
going to sideswipe them.
Sideswipe them.
A little bit.
Now, again, as I said, it's not going to be gaming going away. It's that things are going to change.
Yeah. You know, a lot of the... It's going to seem spooky to some people because a lot of the big names will go overnight or pretty quickly. But, I mean, what you saw with Maxis, I think, is just the beginning. You're losing the edges of it, and then it's gonna creep on inward.
I think the people whose lives are just so massively invested in Call of Duty and Battlefield, mostly Call of Duty, whose lives are so deeply invested in this game.
It's going to seem freakish to them.
It's going to freak them out.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it will.
It's going to freak them out. But I think everything's going to be okay.
It'll be all right.
It'll be okay in the end. Gaming industry will be different.
It's hard to tell what it's going to look like now, but it's taking the shape of it because, I mean, there are a lot of different moving parts than there were back in the 80s.
Yeah.
So the shape of this is going to be different.
Yeah.
But it's still going to be significant, though.
You'll see a lot of the corporate greed disappear. To a certain extent. It won't happen overnight.
It'll be obvious and be reflected in the work.
Yeah.
So it's not going to be working for them that well.
Yeah.
Especially when they're trying to scam people. When you're trying to scam somebody, that means you know you've got a crappy product.
Mm-hmm.
And they're trying to scam people.
Oh, that is... This is why I created this show. Talk about this. Because, you know, this is a big thing. I mean, this is the gaming industry about to go through a massive change, and no one's paying attention. No one's noticing it's coming. Except for a few people.
You always look at it this way. It's, you know, change sometimes is hard,
mm-hmm.
but oftentimes change can be a catalyst for something better.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I'd like to hope that this change that's coming with the gaming industry, this will become a catalyst for a new way of doing gaming that will create even better games, more innovative games, bring innovation back onto the scene,
mm-hmm.
and in a really big way, not just depending on, you know, little companies here to have to do it, but, you know, larger companies are more innovative and more open with what they're doing.
A lot of the innovative, provocative stuff that indie studios are doing become more common.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
That would be very good.
Some stuff would be good. Some stuff would be crap. We'll work through it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But just to see what options there are, because, you know, Company A will produce a game that had a unique particular system in it. Company B will produce a game that had a unique particular system to it. And Company C had a, mm-hmm. creates a game that had a unique particular system to it. And people will look at those particular unique things and say, hey, these would have great synergy together, and put them together and have this really awesome game with these unique elements to them that create this really ultimate awesome game.
Oh, yeah.
That just gets better and better and better each iteration.
Mm-hmm. And that's what's going to happen. And I can't say when. There's no way to know when. But the way things are going.
Many things. Even stock market crash could take one of these guys down.
True. Well, that's another whole other story. But It's not going to be like the crash of 83 or 84. No, 83.
It's kind of hard to have bargain bin boxes on your web store or on your Steam thing. It's like bargain bin boxes. I don't know. It'd be funny. The bargain box. Steam should already go ahead and create something like that called the bargain box.
The bargain box.
The bargain box. Everything in the bargain box is a dollar.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go ahead and set it up right off the top, right? Let's go ahead and get it started. Just call it the bargain box, and, you know, it has a big picture box with a bunch of dead cartridges in it, and everything in that category is a dollar, you know.
Well, you have a lot of companies that are Steam has this thing called Greenlight,
mm-hmm.
where companies submit their games for approval, and it's the gaming community who choose if it gets on Steam or not.
Okay.
And there are these companies that are just tossing these games out there to try and get it on the Steam, to try and make money. And Jim does playthroughs of some of them, and they are awful.
Mm-hmm. Some of these are just
awful. They're trying to make a buck, and they are horrible.
So there's a little bit of, it's not meant, I'm guessing it's not like Apple where it's meant to be corporate level control over what shows up, but quality control, final quality control of the game to say.
There's a lot of shovelware.
Yeah.
Same thing with the mobile game industry. There's a lot of shovelware in the mobile game industry, and there's a lot of exploitation of people with gambling addictions, and people who are addicted with, microtransactions. There's a lot of that in mobile gaming. And if anything happens, I think it might start there.
Yeah, something kind of blows back from some of that.
Yeah.
That's possible. And it ricochets throughout the entire gaming world.
Mm-hmm.
Depends on what it would be, but it's not impossible.
Yeah.
Nothing's impossible.
And that is why I made this show. Talk about stuff like this. And, you know, this is what you're going to expect from future episodes. I mean, this is why I wanted to make this program. To be able to talk about subjects like this. And things that are important to us in geekdom. And we have a very, very good idea for our next episode. Very good idea.
It's probably my fault because of my little project I've been doing recently.
Yeah. Next episode, we're going to be talking about the MCU. The Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Yes.
And I'm not an expert. Neither of us are experts on the comics.
Yeah. Not a comic expert.
Yeah. Not of a comic expert, but I know some of the story of the comic books. But I think what Marvel is doing is very smart.
There's a storytelling aspect of it that I want to get into.
Yeah. And we haven't seen what DC is doing yet. They've had some movies before, but they're basically tossing out those continuities and starting a new one.
Yeah. Anyway, that's a
next That's week another thing. Episode. Yeah. That's going to be for our next episode in 2 weeks. Now, not this weekend, which it's already passed as of this recording, and I'm the God Emperor of procrastination.
God Emperor.
I need to set a hard schedule of every other Thursday doing the show,
okay, recording Lito.
The show for for Friday.
I call you Lito, a.k.a. Lito.
And every weekend we'll be doing the news program. I will be doing periodically the quickies.
Quickies.
I've got some ideas for that. The tips and tricks and suggestions show.
Sounds good.
Throughout the week. Well, thank you for watching or listening, and see you next time. Hope you enjoyed the show. Geektastic Weekly will be a bi-weekly program discussing the latest news in entertainment, games, and technology. If you liked what you heard, please consider subscribing and hitting that like button. See you next time.